Chapter 25, The Prophet of Doom.
I have ordered you to kill them.
Mohammed was a terrorist right to the bitter end.
Tabari, the Prophet ordered the expedition of Usama, but it did not go well because of his illness and because two other Arabs had proclaimed themselves prophets and renounced his authority. The Prophet's head was wrapped around because of the pain.
Superstitious and a believer in occult spells, Mohammed tried to cure himself by going to a magic spring. When that proved insufficient, he blew knots out of a tangle, something that sorcerers practice as part of their black arts. Desperate, he tried praying to Allah, but needless to say, he only got sicker. Allah had never answered prayers to keep folks alive, only to kill them. This prophet's fixation on Satan and his demonic cast of killer angels tells us a great deal about the nature of the man who invented Islam. Many, if not all, of these hadith were revealed during the waning days of his life as he struggled vainly to cheat death.
Bukhari, Allah's apostle said, "While you sleep, Satan ties three knots at the back of your head. He blows the following words at each knot. The night is so long, so keep sleeping. If that person awakes and praises Allah, then one knot is undone. When he performs ablution, the second is undone. When he prays, all the knots are undone, and he gets up in the morning lively and gay. Otherwise, he is dull and gloomy."
Satan's ugly spirit permeates this hideous cult. But I assure you, Satan cannot and does not do these things. All he can do is play havoc with weather and with men's minds. He, like Allah, is otherwise impotent. In this next treasure, we find that Mohammed believed in magic spells. He sought cures identical to the remedies prescribed by the occultists of his day. As you read this angelic encounter, keep in mind that this is how Muhammad alleges the Quran was revealed to him.
Bukhari, magic was worked on Allah's apostle so that he used to think he had sexual relations with his wives when he actually had not.
Apparently, Muhammad had become like his God in yet another way.
That is the hardest kind of magic, and it has such an effect. One day he said, "Oh, Aisha, do you know that Allah has instructed me concerning the matter I asked him about?"
Which was impotence.
"Two men came to me, and one of them sat near my head, and the other near my feet. The one asked, 'What is wrong with this man? He is under the effect of magic.' 'Who cast the magic spell on him?' 'Labid, an Arab ally of the Jews, who was a hypocrite.' 'What material did he use to cast the spell?' 'A comb with hair stuck to it.' 'Where is that comb and hair?' 'In the skin of pollen of a male palm tree, kept under a stone in the well of Darwan.' So the Prophet went to that well and took out those things, saying, 'That was the well shown to me in the dream. Its water looked red, and its palms looked like the heads of devils.' My companions removed those things. I said, 'Why didn't you just treat yourself?' He said, 'Allah has cured me, and I don't want to spread evil among my people.'"
Well, it's a little late for that now. Moreover, the evil spell that possessed the Prophet was not cured by Allah. He would die soon thereafter. A similar Bukhari hadith confirms that Muhammad was a fraud who believed in magic spells, and that his spiritual understanding and medical prowess rendered him more voodoo witch doctor than prophet.
Bukhari, magic was worked on Allah's apostle so that he began to imagine that he had done something although he had not. While he was with me, he evoked Allah for a long period and then said, "Aisha, do you know what Allah has instructed me to do regarding the matter I asked him about? What is that?" He said, "Two men came to me. One said, 'What is the disease of this man?' The other replied, 'He is under the effect of magic.' 'Who has worked magic on him?' 'Labid, a Jew from the Zurayk tribe.'"
By saying that his disease was spiritual, not biological, Muhammad became a witch doctor. by contradicting himself and saying that the perpetrator was a Jew rather than a Muslim hypocrite, he demonstrated that he couldn't be trusted. Back a couple of chapters, I shared some inspired scripture from Bukhari's Book of Wudu. I saved this one because of its reference to demons.
Bukhari, I carried a water pot for the Prophet's ablution and for cleaning his private parts. While following him with the pot, the Prophet turned and said, "Who are you?" "I am Abu." The Prophet said, "Bring me stones in order to clean my private parts, but do not bring any animal bones or animal dung." So I brought some stones, carrying them in the corner of my robe, till I put them by his side. When he finished, I walked with him and asked, "What can you tell me about the bones and the animal dung?" He said, "They are the food of jinns."
Devils.
A delegate of jinns of the city of Nasibin came to me. How nice those jinns were! And they asked me for the remains of human food. I invoked Allah for them, that they would never pass by a bone or animal dung, but find food on them.
I'm not surprised Mohammed thought demons were nice. Nor am I surprised that he believes they eat dung and bones. In fact, that pretty much sums up Islam. As we mosey down this trail of discovery, occasionally something catches our eye that is particularly revealing. We find this in Muslim, chapter 14, book 39, number 6759.
Aisha, the wife of Allah's apostle, may peace be upon him, reported, "Allah's messenger, may peace be upon him, left my apartment during the night, and he came and he saw me in an agitated state. He said, 'Aisha, what has happened to you? Do you feel jealous?' I said, 'How can it be that a girl like me would not feel jealous in regard to a husband like you?'"
You've got to admire her wit. She was sharing a 62-year-old pervert, I mean prophet, with 24 other children, sex slaves, concubines, and wives of every faith and description. It's only reasonable that she should express some anxiety.
"In regard to a husband like
him."
Thereupon Allah's messenger said, "It is your devil who has come to you."
Bingo! Her devil had indeed come to her.
I said, "Allah's messenger, is there a devil with me?" He said, "Yes." I said, "Is there a devil attached to everyone?" He said, "Yes." I said, "Allah's messenger, is there a devil attached to you also?"
Now for the moment of truth.
He said, "Yes."
Muhammad finally got something right. But alas, even that was wrong. The hadith ends with the Prophet saying,
"But my Lord has helped me against my devil, and as such I am absolutely safe from his mischief."
The spirit that controls demons is Satan. They stopped reporting to Yahweh at least 6,000 years ago. As we have learned, mischief has a peculiar Islamic definition. A mischief maker is someone who rejects Muhammad, Allah, the Quran, his Sunnah, and Islam. No doubt Satan, as Muhammad's Lord, ordered the devil who possessed his prophet to keep him from such mischief. Demons provide the bookends for Islam. 22 years earlier, Islam was born when Muhammad received a recital from a demonic spirit late one night. The experience was horrible, nearly pressing the life out of him. The new prophet tried to commit suicide. Terrorized, he ran home to his 60-year-old wife, crying,
"I fear that something bad has happened to me. I have been possessed."
Now in the throes of death, days from his last breath, Allah's messenger tells his teenage wife that the devil has never left him. He had become comfortable enough with his demonic spirit to explain that the
devil
was
attached to him.
There was no one closer to Islam's godfather than Aisha. Every hadith reporting the circumstances surrounding the birth of Islam and the death of its prophet come from her lips. She alone reported the nature of the Quran revelations, saying that the inspiration process was like the clanging bell in her husband's head. She also said,
"Anyone who claims Muhammad saw Gabriel more than twice is a liar."
And that's a serious problem, because a devil was attached to him. It's little wonder that he was morally bankrupt and vicious. But more important than that, Satan, by controlling Muhammad's devil, was able to control his prophet. It is why his example was so abysmal, as in from the abyss. It's why his sunnah was a terrorist manifesto, and why the Quran was so mean-spirited. Satan knows nothing of choice. Thus, Islam was all about submission, about obedience. Satan knows nothing of love. Thus, Islam focused on hate and on fear. Satan despises truth, life, and especially salvation. Thus, Islam was about deceit, death, and especially damnation. The reason why has just been explained. He was the devil's advocate. Muhammad confirmed publicly what he had revealed privately to Asia in this hadith chronicled by Muslim, chapter 14, book 39, number 6757.
Allah's messenger said, "There is none amongst you with whom is not an attaché from among the jinn, a devil." The companion said, "Allah's messenger, is there a devil with you too?" Thereupon he said, "Yes, but Allah helps me against him, so I am safe from his hand, and he does not command me but for good."
The first thing that Team Islam did was to redefine its terms. Most bad things are considered good. For example, terrorism is good. So is jihad, holy fighting in Allah's cause. Stealing booty is good. So is incest, rape, and slavery. While we're on the subject of demons in Islam, I want to provide a variety of supporting confessions. The first is troubling because the Quran's initial revelation was a nightmare.
Bukhari, the Prophet said, "A good dream is from Allah, and a bad or evil dream is from Satan. So if any one of you has a bad dream of which he is afraid, he should spit on his left side."
Speaking of nocturnal deceptions.
Bukhari, the Prophet said, "Cover your utensils and tie your waterskins. Close your doors and keep your children close at night, as jinn spread out and snatch things. When you go to bed, put out your lights, for the mischief doer may drag away the candle and burn your house with you in it." Atta said, the Prophet actually said devils instead of jinn.
Occult soothsayers are demonic messengers. As such, Muhammad knew all about them.
Bukhari, the Prophet said, "While angels talk amidst the clouds about things that are going to happen, the devils hear what they say and pour it in the ears of soothsayers, as one pours something in a bottle, and they add 100 lies to it."
This next hadith should send a jolt of terror up every Muslim spine. Muhammad's Quran was recited in rhyme speech called Rijaz poetry. So were many of these hadiths.
Muslim, Allah's messenger said, "He seems to be one of the soothsayers on account of the rhymed speech which he has composed."
So would that make Muhammad a soothsayer, or just the father of rap? Bukhari tells us in Volume 4, Book 54, Number 494,
Allah's apostle said, "When the edge of the sun appears, don't perform a prayer until the sun appears in full. And when the lower edge of the sun sets, don't perform a prayer until it sets completely. And you should not seek to pray at sunrise or sunset, for the sun rises between the two sides of the head of the devil, Satan."
In his witch doctor mode, the Prophet proclaimed,
Bukhari, "Fever is from the heat of the hell fire, so cool it with water."
A devil must have disobeyed Satan's command, so?
Bukhari, the Prophet said, "A strong demon from the jinn came to me yesterday suddenly, so as to spoil my prayer, but Allah enabled me to overpower him, and so I caught him and intended to tie him to one of the pillars of the mosque, so that you all might see him."
With each satanic verse, Islam continued to self-destruct.
Bukhari, Allah's apostle said, "When the Adhan,
the call to prayer,
is announced, Satan takes to his heels and passes wind with noise during his flight in order not to hear the Adhan."
While Satan is an ass in the figurative sense, he lacks human anatomy and thus a digestive system and anus.
Bukhari, Satan circulates in the human being as blood circulates. I was afraid lest Satan might insert an evil thought in your minds.
While Satan hasn't circulated within anyone, including Muhammad, the damage he did was far worse. Islam corrodes its victims' minds so that they lose the ability to think rationally. Then moving from back to front and inside out, we find
Bukhari. The Prophet said, yawning is from Satan, and if any one of you yawns, you should check his yawning as much as possible. If anyone during the act of yawning should say, ha, Satan will laugh at him.
Our satanic journey continues with
Bukhari. A person slept in and missed the morning prayer, so the Prophet said, Satan urinated in his ears.
If Satan and Allah were not the same, Satan would have no reason to be troubled by a Muslim missing a prayer to Allah. Not a moment too soon, our anatomical voyage ends with
Bukhari. The Prophet said, if anyone rouses from sleep and performs ablution, he should wash his nose by putting water in it and then blow it out thrice, because Satan has stayed in the upper part of his nose all night.
If Muhammad had aspired to be nothing more than a witch doctor, his patients would have sued him for malpractice. How is it then that a billion people trust this false prophet with their souls? This next hadith requires some thinking. It opens with a prophetic order to protect the prophet's booty, and it closes with a conundrum.
Bukhari, Allah's apostle ordered me to guard the zakat revenue of Ramadan. Then somebody came and started stealing the food stuff. I caught him and said, I am going to take you to Allah's apostle. He replied, please don't take me to him. If you spare me that fate, I will tell you a few words by which Allah will benefit you. So then he said, when you go to bed, recite Ayat al-Kursi.
Quran 2, 255.
For then a guard from Allah will protect you all night long, and Satan will not be able to come near you till dawn. When the Prophet heard the story, he said to me, he who came to you at night told you the truth, although he is a liar, and it was Satan.
By this time, there were only Muslims in Medina, so the order to guard the storehouse means that the first Muslims couldn't be trusted. The thief couldn't be Satan, for why would a spirit steal food? Further, why would someone trust a thief, or Satan, to share Quranic insights? The reference verse, Quran 2, 255, says that Allah is God and that everything belongs to Him. Quoting it makes no sense if Satan is Allah's enemy. But it makes perfect sense if Satan is using Allah as a disguise. Yet by saying that it will protect one from Satan, it no longer makes sense. But speaking of senseless, how can one who told the truth be a liar? So I don't leave you in the same quandary Muhammad left his stooge. The answer is simple. Satan is everywhere in Islam. He is in the Quran. He is in the Prophet. He is in the bodies of believers, in their homes, in Muhammad's harem, in his booty. Satan is a liar. So each time the Quran says, verily, truthfully, truly, surely, the right path, or the true religion, rest assured, he's lying. There is a reason the Sunnah says,
Tabari, Satan cast a false Quran revelation on the messenger of Allah's tongue.
It's the same reason Surah 22:52 claims,
every messenger or prophet before you recited the message Satan cast into his recitation.
Returning to Islam's deathbed, we find in Tabari, Volume 9, page 166,
may Allah curse those who make the tombs of their prophets places of worship.
The dying man grumbled, not knowing that Jews don't have shrines, and Christians celebrate the fact that Christ doesn't have a tomb. Yet in Bukhari we read,
the Prophet in his fatal illness said, Allah cursed Jews and Christians because they took their prophets' graves as places for praying. Tabari, Muhammad waged war against the false prophets.
Slitting his own wrists would have done quite nicely.
By sending messengers with instructions to get rid of them by artful contrivance.
Hitler had a word for artful contrivances too. Propaganda. Con men don't like competition. Even today, Islam deceives its non-Muslim enemies using al-takiyya, which means the legal lie. Calling jihad a spiritual struggle is a takiyya. His rivals eliminated, the Prophet turned his attention to weightier matters.
Tabari, he turned to me, saying, Abu Muahila, I have been given the keys of the treasuries of this world.
It was always about the money. While demons provide the bookends for history's most
artful contrivance,
nothing but money and blood fills the pages in between. Knowing that the Grim Reaper was calling his name, Muhammad decided to visit his final accommodation.
Tabari, Aisha said, when the messenger returned from the Baqi cemetery, he found me. He was suffering from a headache and crying, "Alas, O my head!" He moaned, "Nay, by Allah, O Aisha, rather, alas, O my head!"
To know he suffered is some small consolation to the billions he has made suffer.
Then he said, "Would it distress you if you were to die before me, so that I could take care of your body, wrap you in a shroud, pray over you, and bury you?"
The hadith says that Aisha was just 18 years old, so she was a little young to be buried. However, Muslims were never very good with math. Since we're in the 11th year of the Islamic era, and the 53-year-old prophet married his child bride at its onset, she must have been 7, not 9, when she was removed from the swing, plucked from childhood, and thrust into his lap.
Aisha replied, "It seems to me that if you were to do that, you would return to my apartments and would party with one of your other wives."
Out of the mouths of babes. While out visiting his future quarters, the prophet revealed this racist verse.
Bukhari, the prophet went out after sunset and heard a dreadful voice. He said, "The Jews are being punished in their graves." Bukhari, when the ailment of Allah's apostle became aggravated, he requested his wives to permit him to be nursed in my apartment. They gave him permission. He came out between two men with his feet dragging on the ground.
Reverting to witchcraft, we read in both Tabari and Bukhari,
the messenger's illness intensified, the pain became fierce. So he said, after entering my apartment, "Pour 7 skins of water over me from different wells, and from skins whose mouths have not been untied, so that I may give advice to the people."
Feeling guilty and dreading his own encounter with eternity, he said,
"Your rights are dear to me, so whomever I have flogged on his back with a whip, here is my back, let him avenge. Whomever I have reviled, here is my honor, let him retort, that he should absolve me from it, so that I shall meet the Lord while I am exonerated."
Yes, it's true. Muhammad was concerned about meeting his Lord. Islam's lone prophet was unsure of his own salvation.
Bukhari, when Allah's apostle became seriously sick, he started covering his face with a woolen sheet. When he felt short of breath, he removed it and said, "That is so, Allah's curse be on Jews and Christians."
I don't think he had a nice bone in his entire body.
Tabari, the messenger's pain became so severe, he said, "Give me pen and paper so I may write a document for you, so that you will never go astray after me."
He knew that the Quran was rubbish, and he was trying to make amends. Yet there's a time bomb lurking in Muhammad's unguarded words. His timeless document was going to be from him, not his God. There was no pretense of receiving divine revelation. His final masterpiece was going to be from his own hand. Speaking of the Quran, guess what? Muhammad never asked or ordered anyone to collect his surahs and write them down in a book. Not one person, not one time, ever. With 1,000 obey me, 1,000 pay me, and 1,000 go out and fight for me, there wasn't one write for me. He knew the Quran was only revealed to serve his interest, and that it would be of no value once he was gone. Recognizing that their prophet was illiterate and about to make a fool of himself, we read,
his companions wrangled over it, but it did not benefit them to carry on a dispute before a prophet. Some people said, "What is the matter with him? Is he talking nonsense? He is delusional."
It's a shame it took so long to figure it out.
Others said, "We must ask him for an explanation." So they went back to him and repeated what had been said. The prophet replied, "Leave me alone."
Bukhari reports it this way.
The ailment of Allah's apostle became worse. He said, "Fetch me something so that I may write something to keep you from going astray." The people differed in this matter, and it was not right to differ before a prophet. Some said, "What is wrong with him? Do you think he is delirious? Let's ask him." So they went to the prophet and asked. He said, "Leave me, for my present state is better than what you question me about." Then he ordered them to do three things. He said, "Turn the pagans out of the Arabian Peninsula. Give gifts to the foreign delegations as you have seen me dealing with them."
That was it. So like I said, Muslims were never very good at math. Another hadith reports,
Tabari, "Bring me a tablet or a plank of the shoulder blade and an inkpot so that I can write for you a document after which you will not go astray." Some said, "The messenger of Allah is out of his mind."
This confirms my speculation. Muhammad was proposing a new revelation from himself to keep his followers obedient, even after his death.
Bukhari, when the prophet was on his deathbed and there were some men in his house, he said, "Come near, I will write something to keep you obedient." His companion said, "Allah's apostle is seriously ill, and we have the Quran. Allah's book is sufficient." So they started disputing. Some said, "Give him some writing material." Others said the other way around. So when their differences increased, Allah's apostle said, "Get out." No doubt it was very unfortunate and a great disaster that he was prevented from writing that writing because of their differences and noise.
It wouldn't have made a difference, because it wouldn't have been different. Muhammad was Allah, which is why the Quran and Hadith speak with one voice.
Bukhari, the prophet in his ailment used to say, "Aisha, I feel the pain caused by the food I ate at Khaibar. My aorta is being cut from that poison."
If it were true, Muhammad would be elevated to martyr status. He'd gain a direct pass into Allah's brothel and earn 70 virgins rather than the regular allotment. I dare say Muhammad was no fun to nurse.
Bukhari, we poured medicine on one side of the prophet's mouth, and he started pointing to us, meaning to say, "Don't pour medicine in me." When he felt a little better, he said, "Didn't I forbid you to pour medicine in my mouth?" We said, "We thought it was because of the dislike patients have for them." He said, "Let everyone in the house be given medicine by pouring it in his mouth while I am looking at him."
Blowing and cupping were both prescribed Islamic cures and satanic practices. The prophet preferred them.
Bukhari, Aisha said, "Whenever the prophet went to bed, he used to cup his hands together and blow over them, rubbing his hands over what parts of his body he was able to rub. He used to do that three times." Bukhari, when Allah's apostle became ill, he used to recite the last two surahs of the Quran and then blow his breath and pass his hands over himself. When he had his fatal illness, I started reciting and blowing my breath over him as he used to do. Then I rubbed the hand of the prophet over his body.
The Quran had not yet been ordered, so there was no way of knowing the first surah from the last one. But should Aisha have been right, Muhammad ended his life speaking of himself. The 114th surah says,
"I seek refuge with the Lord of men, the King of men, from the evil of the whispering devil who blows temptations into the minds of men, who suggests evil thoughts to the hearts of men, from among the demons and men."
It's hard to imagine a more incriminating way for a prophet, especially this one, to end his life.
Bukhari, I heard the prophet while he was lying on his back say, "O Allah, forgive me."
Even Muhammad could have been forgiven, but not by Allah. And that's why this false prophet was in such agony.
Bukhari, Aisha said, "Allah's apostle in his fatal illness used to ask, 'Where will I be tomorrow? Where will I be tomorrow?'"
This next hadith is as nonsensical as the rest of Islam.
Bukhari, I used to hear the Prophet say that no prophet dies until he is given the option to select either the worldly life or the life of the hereafter.
Sorry, not all prophets are scum, and they certainly aren't this stupid. Muhammad is saying that after a lifetime of dedicating oneself to God's calling and to revealing His truth, prophets are asked if they want to renounce their mission. The first Muslims were a conniving and covetous lot.
Bukhari, Ali came to the house of Allah's apostle during his fatal illness. The people asked, "How is the health of Muhammad this morning?" Ali replied, "He has recovered with the grace of Allah." Abbas bin Abdul Muttalib held him by the hand and said, "He will die from all this ailment, for I know how the faces of the offspring of Abdul Muttalib look at the time of their death. So let us go to him and ask who will take over the caliphate. If it is given to us, we will know, and if it is given to somebody else, we will inform him, so that he may tell the new ruler to take care of us." Ali said, "If we asked him for the caliphate and he denied it to us, the people will never give it to us after that."
Loitering in the mosque just outside the doorway to Aisha's apartment, some Muslims in Tabati
said they were afraid that he might have pleurisy. He said, "Pleurisy is from Satan, and Allah would not inflict it on me." Tabari, before Muhammad died, he cried, "O my Lord, help me overcome the severity of the agony of death." Bukhari, Aisha said, "It was one of the favors of Allah toward me that his apostle expired in my apartment on the day of my turn when he was leaning on my chest, and Allah made my saliva mix with his at his death. Abd Rahman entered upon me with a siwak in his hand, and I was supporting Muhammad against my chest. I saw the Prophet looking at it, and I knew he loved the siwak. So I said, 'Shall I take it for you?' He nodded. It was too stiff for him to use, so I softened it as he nodded his approval. He cleaned his teeth with it, crying, 'Death has its tortures.'" Tabari, Aisha said, "Muhammad rubbed his teeth with it more energetically than I had ever seen him doing before. Then he put it down, and I found him getting heavy in my lap, and he died."
He knew that he had dispensed some of the most revolting poison ever spoken. Millions would die, and billions would be damned, as a result of the words that had left his mouth. So seeing Muhammad use his last measure of life to scrub his mouth of death is the perfect way to say goodbye to the most evil man who had ever lived. Only one problem. Muhammad wasn't supposed to die. Allah had promised him. And then there was the messianic problem. Yeshua had raised men from the dead, and Christ himself had not died, according to Allah. Remember the night's journey? All of the prior prophetic big shots, Adam, Abraham, Moses, and Jesus, were all alive, joining Islam's hallucinogenic prophet in the temple that wasn't there for a prayer and a glass of milk. Muhammad was supposed to be better than all of them.
Bukhari, Abu Bakr came from his
stolen
house at Asun on a
stolen
horse. He dismounted and entered the mosque, but he did not speak to the people till he entered upon Aisha and went straight to Allah's apostle, who was covered with a
stolen
Yemenite cloth. He uncovered the Prophet's face and bowed over him and kissed him and wept, saying, "Let my father and mother be sacrificed for you. Allah will never cause you to die twice. As for the death which was written for you, it has come upon you."
It's telling that Baker
bowed over him.
The spirit that had made Baker rich and powerful had been Muhammad's, not Allah's. Baker's willingness to
sacrifice his father and mother
to save the soul of his fallen comrade is also telling. The first Muslims had been corrupted to the point that they had willingly and gleefully killed their closest relatives, and Muhammad had never given Muslims a plan of salvation. They lack a rational solution to the problem of sin, even today. There is no atoning sacrifice to accept or to perform to obtain forgiveness and thus come into the presence of a holy God. But then again, that's not a problem for Islam. Their God is anything but holy.
Tabari, When the Prophet died, Umar stood up threatening the people, saying, "Some of the hypocrites allege that the Messenger of Allah is dead. I swear by Allah that he is alive, not dead. By Allah, the Prophet will return, and he will go after those who are spreading lies about him. He will cut off the hands and feet of those who claim that he is dead. He will crucify them."
Sorry, pal. He was certifiably and undeniably dead, and not a moment too soon.
Bukhari. When Umar was talking to the people, Abu Bakr said, "Sit down, Umar," but he refused. So the people came to Abu and left him. Bakr said, "To proceed, if you used to worship Muhammad, then Muhammad is dead. But if any one of you used to worship Allah, then Allah is alive and shall never die." Allah said, "Muhammad is no more than an apostle, and indeed apostles have passed away before him."
This is recorded in Quran 3:144.
By Allah, it was as if the people never knew Allah had revealed this verse before Abu recited it. Umar said, "When I heard Bakr, my legs could not support me, and I fell down, declaring that the Prophet had died."
Abu Bakr just confirmed what I have been saying from the very beginning. Muslims
used to worship Muhammad.
Not out of respect, mind you. They worshipped Muhammad for the same reason they would come to worship Allah. They feared him. They knew good Muslims would kill them the moment they stopped. And let's not forget, Islam had its reward. Jihad became holy, and booty had been made lawful and good. Islam's first historian paints the drama like this.
Tabari. Bakr saw that Umar would not listen. He went forward. "I swear by the Lord of the Kaaba that Muhammad is gone. Those people who formerly worshipped Muhammad must know that the deity you worshipped is dead. Those who formerly worshipped Allah must know that Allah is still alive and immortal."
In death, Muhammad had given birth to the God he had conceived in life. They were separate and distinct for the first time.
Bukhari. It was mentioned in the presence of Aisha that the Prophet had appointed Ali as successor by will. She said, "Who says so? I was with the Prophet, supporting him against my chest, when he expired. I didn't hear anything. So how do the people say he appointed Ali as successor?"
Aisha had never forgiven Ali when, after her little indiscretion, he had told Muhammad,
"Women are plentiful. You can always exchange her for another one." Bukhari. I asked Abdallah, "Did the Prophet make a will?" He replied, "No." I asked, "How come?"
Because Satan had deceived his Prophet. But his promise of eternal life was as useless as his promise of virgins for jihadists. Umar and Bakr were at their wits' end, to be sure, but so was Ali. He craved the power others were swooshing in to grab. Before the body was cold, they were assembling their allies.
Tabari. Zubair drew his sword, saying, "I will not put it back until the oath of allegiance is rendered to Ali." When this news reached Abu Bakr and Umar, the latter said, "Hit him with a stone and seize the sword."
Recognizing that Islam had been Muhammad's ticket to babes, to booty, and to power, the boys were ruthless.
Tabari. Fatimah,
Muhammad's daughter,
and Ali,
Muhammad's adopted son and Fatimah's husband,
came to Bakr demanding their share of inheritance of the messenger. They demanded Muhammad's land in Fadak and his share of Khaibar's tribute.
But Bakr was unmoved. He had sacrificed his 6-year-old daughter to make sure no one would cheat him out of what Muhammad had stolen.
Fatimah shunned him and did not speak to Bakr until she died. Ali buried her at night and did not permit Abu Bakr to attend her burial.
This spat over money was not without consequence. It caused the rift that separated Sunni from Shiite. The scam that had been conceived to enrich its prophet had split over booty. How poetic. Bukhari covers the financial feud this way.
Fatimah came to Abu Bakr, claiming her inheritance of the Prophet's land of Fadak and his share from Khaibar. Abu said, "I heard the Prophet say, 'Our property is not inherited.'"
Muslims the world over are brainwashed to believe that their Prophet died broke, with nothing more than his robe and sandals. But that, like so much of Islam, is simply not true. For example,
Bukhari, there was a man who looked after the family and the belongings of the Prophet, called Karkara. He died, and Allah's Apostle said, he is in the hell fire. He has stolen a cloak from the Prophet's war booty.
Buried among the money-grubbing hadith are two that contradict a score of others.
Bukhari, the Prophet died while his armor was mortgaged to a Jew for 30 sa's of barley.
Sorry, I'm not buying that. Muhammad and his pals had murdered, enslaved, and exiled every Jew worth robbing. And?
Bukhari, Allah's Apostle did not leave a dinar or dirham or a male or female slave. He left only his white mule on which he used to ride, and his weapons, and a piece of land which he gave in charity for the needy travelers.
So for argument's sake, let's say that this one is right and all the others are wrong. It really doesn't matter if he died covered in stolen plunder or not. The fact he stole is what's important. Criminal behavior destroys his credibility. The fact that he owned and used slaves, especially female slaves, speaks to his depraved character as well. And the fact that the most inspired Sunni scriptures in Islam conflict with one another suggests that none of this can be trusted, and that's important too.
Bukhari, Fatimah, the daughter of the Prophet, sent someone to Bakr asking for her inheritance of what Allah's Apostle had left of the property taken from the Fi booty gained without fighting in Medina and Fadak, and what remained of the Kumas.
Muhammad's fifth of the booty gained through fighting.
Of the Khaybar booty. On that, Abu said, our property is not inherited. Whatever we leave is sadaka. But the family of Muhammad can eat of this property. I will not make any change in the estate of the Apostle, and will dispose of it as he used to.
Bribing men to fight.
So Bakr refused to give anything to Fatimah. She became angry. When she died, her husband Ali buried her at night, without informing Bakr, and he said the funeral prayer by himself. When Fatimah was alive, the people used to respect Ali, but after her death, Ali noticed a change in the people's attitudes toward him, so he sought reconciliation with Bakr.
The warlord is dead. Long live the warlord.
Ali sent someone to Bakr saying, come to me, but let nobody come with you, as he disliked Umar. But Umar said, no, not alone. Ali uttered tashahud,
a ritual prayer,
and said, I know your superiority and am not jealous, but you did not consult me in the question of rulership, and I thought that I had a right to rule because of my near relationship to Allah's Apostle. Thereupon, Bakr's eyes flowed with tears. As for the trouble which arose between me and you about his property, I will spend it according to what is good, and will not leave any rule or regulation which I saw Allah's Apostle following in disposing of it.
In other words, you're out of luck, kid. I've already grabbed the power and the money, and I'm not giving you either.
Ali added, I believe that I have some rights in this affair, and when you did not consult me in these matters, it caused me to feel sorry.
Even Aisha wasn't keen on the idea of her dad running the Islamic war machine.
Bukhari, Aisha added, I had argued with Allah's Apostle repeatedly about his order that Abu Bakr should lead the people in his place. What made me argue so much was that it never occurred to my mind that after the Prophet, the people would ever love a man who had taken his place. I felt that anybody standing in his place would be a bad omen to the people, so I wanted him to give up the idea of choosing Dad.
There was more bickering. The Meccans wanted to return the Kaaba's custodianship back to the line of Qusay. Bakr didn't qualify. And with the warlord dead, Arabs stopped paying the zakat tax. That was a problem, because there was no village in Arabia left to rob. Islam was teetering on financial ruin. So Bakr did what any good fundamentalist Muslim would have done. He grabbed his sword, called his fellow militants, and forced the entire subcontinent into submission. He called it the War of Compulsion. Bakr, like Muhammad, was in it for the money. This hadith is very incriminating. There is no suggestion of salvation. Religious ritual is discounted, but money continues to reign supreme.
Bukhari, when the Prophet died, Arabs reverted to disbelief. Umar asked Bakr, should we fight these people? Allah's apostle said, I have been ordered to fight everyone until they say, none has the right to be worshipped but Allah. Bakr replied, by Allah, I will fight whoever differentiates between the salat,
a prayer performance,
and the zakat,
a tax payment.
As the zakat must be taken from property according to Allah's orders, if they refuse to pay me, I will fight them. Umar said, I noticed that Allah opened Bakr's chest toward the decision to fight.
All the while, the pungent aroma of Muhammad's rotting body was fouling his mosque, so the decision was made to bury the dead prophet as he had lived, beneath the bed upon which he had died morally a decade earlier.
Tabari, they buried him where he died. Aisha's bed was removed, and a grave was dug beneath it.
The profiteer whose religious scam had been conceived, when terrified and suicidal, he had crawled into the bed of his 60-year-old wife, died in the bed of his child bride. Mission completed, he had gained property, pleasure, and power. But at what cost? I was not the only American troubled by the senseless acts of violence that preceded the destruction of the World Trade Centers, or by the carnage that followed. The lethality of the poison required for men to believe that slaughtering innocent souls is a service to God is beyond comprehension. Now, 2 years after having met personally with terrorists from Al-Qaeda, Hamas, Al-Aqsa Martyrs Brigade, and Islamic Jihad, and having studied the Islamic scriptures they quoted, I am repulsed, but I am no longer unaware. I recognize that the terrorists have not corrupted their religion. Islam has corrupted them. And I know that Muslim militants will continue to slaughter Christians and Jews, peaceful Muslims and atheists alike. We can either eliminate Islam so that there is no longer an incentive for them to kill, or we can let Muslims eliminate us. Those are the only two options we have been given. They have declared holy war, and we must respond. Sadly, all we have done thus far is to parade Islam's most articulate clerics and politicos on television and let them deceive our nation. Our president has lied to us. Our pastors, priests, and rabbis don't seem to care. Fact is, many have been willing to sacrifice your life for money and power. It's like Islam in a way. Muslims threaten clerics, politicians, and the media with angry demonstrations, protestations, boycotts, and even death if they speak out honestly about the obvious correlation between Islam and terror. Thus far, I have shared hundreds of Quran verses commanding Muslims to fight. Muhammad, speaking for Allah, made himself perfectly clear.
Quran 8, verse 7. Allah wished to confirm the truth by his words, wipe the disbelieving infidels out to the last. Quran 8, verse 39. So fight them until all opposition to Islam ends and all are obedient to Allah.
Speaking for himself, Muhammad unleashed the very same sword. This prophet blessed us with countless jihad hadith chronicled by the likes of Ishaq, Tabari, and Bukhari. In the Sirah, Ishaq reported Muhammad having said,
kill the disbelievers wherever you find them. Lie in wait for them. Ambush them. Overwhelm them. I have ordered you to kill them. Tabari, the battle cry of Muhammad's companions was, kill, kill, kill. Bukhari, Allah's apostle said, I have been ordered to fight people until they say, none has the right to be worshipped but Allah.
The four most important and holy books in Islam speak with the same voice. So what about the fifth? What does Muslim have to say about the first Muslims? His voice must be heard too, as no Islamic scholar disputes the authenticity of his inspired collection of hadith. By way of background, Muslim was born in 202 AH and died in 933 AD.
He traveled widely to gather his collection of hadith, including to Iraq, Saudi Arabia, Syria, and Egypt. Out of 300,000 hadith which he evaluated, only 4,000 were extracted for inclusion into his collection, based on stringent acceptance criteria.
He had a great deal to report on the subject of jihad. In fact, what he had to say is hard to miss. Muslim begins his dissertation under the title,
Command for Fighting Against People So Long as They Do Not Profess That There Is No Illah But Allah and Muhammad Is His Messenger.
The first tradition is a bolder version of a Bukhari hadith, confirming the first Islamic caliphs fought for money, not souls.
Muslim. When the messenger breathed his last and Bakr was appointed caliph, many Arabs chose to become apostates.
Which means, given the opportunity, they ceased being Muslims. They rejected Muhammad, Allah, and the Quran.
Umar said, Why would you fight against these people? Bakr replied, I would definitely fight against anyone who stopped paying the zakat, for it is an obligation. I would fight against them even to secure the cord used for hobbling the feet of a camel. Umar remarked, Allah had opened the heart of Bakr for understanding the justification of fighting against those who refused to pay the zakat.
The war of compulsion enslaved all Arabs. The reason for fighting was money. Islam stole Arab property and Arab freedoms.
Muslim. The messenger said, I have been commanded to fight against people so long as they do not declare that there is no God but Allah.
That means Muslims must fight and kill non-Muslims until there are no more non-Muslims. No matter how you translate or interpret this hadith, that is what these words mean. The only way to avoid the sword of Islam and the loss of life and property is to become one. Even then, if you don't pay the zakat tax and obey their every command, Muslims will hunt you down and kill you. And should you decide to leave their cult, they will kill you for that too. There will be no peace until there is no Islam.
Muslim. The messenger said, I have been commanded to fight against people until they testify that there is no God but Allah, and they believe in me, that I am the messenger, and in all that I have brought.
That would be the sunnah which is derived from these hadith.
And when they do it, their blood and riches are protected.
Muslims are commanded to follow Muhammad's example. They are ordered to fight non-Muslims in the Quran. Now, all people on earth, you and me included, are required to
believe in Muhammad
and to
believe Muhammad was God's messenger
if we want to live. And then to add insult to injury, if we want Muslims to spare our
blood and riches,
we must believe in
all that Muhammad brought.
All would include the entirety of the deeds and words recorded by Bukhari, Muslim, Ishaq, Tabari, and Allah. Go back and read Muhammad's creation accounts if you need to be reminded as to how insane such capitulation would be. And continue to read this collection of what
Muhammad brought
if you would like to know how lethal Islam can be. Lest you think that this dire threat is an aberration, an isolated warning, consider this from Chapter 9, Book 1, Number 33.
The Prophet said, I have been commanded to fight against people until they testify that there is no God but Allah, that Muhammad is the messenger of Allah, and they established prostration prayer and pay the zakat. If they do it, their blood and property are protected.
And if they don't submit, they don't obey, they don't pay, they lose their blood and their property.
Muslim. Muhammad, may peace be upon him, sent us in a raiding party. We raided Hurakat in the morning. I caught hold of a man, and he said, There is no God but Allah. But I attacked him with a spear anyway. It once occurred to me that I should ask the apostle about this. The messenger said, Did he profess there is no God but Allah? And even then you killed him? I said, He made a profession out of the fear of the weapon I was threatening him with. The Prophet observed, Did you tear out his heart in order to find whether it professed truly or not? By Allah, I would never kill any Muslim, so long as a person with a heavy belly would not kill. Upon this, a person remarked, Did Allah not say, And fight them until there is no more mischief, and religion is holy for Allah?
While I do not understand Muhammad's question regarding cutting out a man's heart, nor the reference to obesity, I know what Allah had to say about this specific subject.
Quran 5:33, the punishment for those who wage war against Allah and His Messenger and strive after corruption, making mischief in the land,
those who refuse to surrender to Islam,
is murder, execution, crucifixion, the cutting off of hands and feet on opposite sides, or they should be imprisoned. That is their degradation and disgrace in this world, and a great torment of an awful doom awaits them in the hereafter, except for those who repent and become Muslims, before you overpower them and they fall into your control.
According to Allah, the Muslim militant who overpowered his victim and then impaled him after a confession of faith was justified. Since Muhammad revealed this surah, and since it was his last, and thus the most current in his memory, he should have known this as well. But he didn't recite it, even though it provided a direct answer to the man's query. Instead, he proposed a ghoulish conundrum. The following is similar, yet contradictory, all at the same time.
Muslim, the messenger, may peace be upon him, sent us to raid Hurakat, a tribe of Arabs. We attacked the tribe early in the morning and defeated them. I and an Ansar man caught hold of a person of the defeated tribe. When we overcame him, he said, "There is no illah but Allah." At that moment, the Ansari spared him, but I attacked him with my spear and killed him. The news had already reached the apostle, so when we came back, he said, "Usama, did you kill him after he made the profession? There is no illah but Allah?" I said, "He did it only as a shelter. Did you kill him after he made the profession?" He went on repeating this to me until I wished I had not embraced Islam.
Keep in mind that contradictory scripture is untrustworthy scripture. Liars lie. That's what liars do. And speaking of liars, Muhammad demonstrated an inability to recall or apply his own scriptures. If I know them, why didn't he? Those who say Islam is a religion of peace and jihad is a spiritual struggle should have this verse tattooed on their foreheads. Like the scarlet letters in days gone by, we could use it to more readily recognize those who would deceive us so that others might kill us more readily.
Muslim, the Prophet, may peace be upon him, said at the conquest of Mecca, "There is no migration now, but only jihad, fighting for the cause of Islam." When you are asked to set out on a jihad expedition, you should readily go.
There is only jihad. When Muslims are called to jihad, they must go without hesitation. If they don't, they become hypocrites or apostates, who must be killed as a way of encouraging future jihadists.
Muslim, we used to take oaths to Muhammad that we would listen to and obey his orders.
Islam was an oath to serve and obey Muhammad, period. Since he is dead now, why are so many people enslaved by him?
Muslim, I saw Allah's messenger, may peace be upon him, twisting the forelock of a horse with his fingers as he was saying, "A great benefit, a reward for rearing them for jihad. The spoils of war have been tied to the forelocks of horses."
Just imagine what was going through his twisted mind as he was lying to his people this way. The 28th chapter of Muslim is entitled
Merit of Jihad and Campaigning in the Way of Allah.
There is nothing moral or spiritual in it. The first hadith lets us know that jihad is a selfish act, that jihad is a call to war, and that Muhammad was a liar.
Muslim, Allah's apostle, may peace be unto him, said, "Allah has undertaken to look after the affairs of one who goes out to fight in his way, believing in him and affirming the truth of his apostle. He is committed that he will either admit him to paradise or bring him back to his home with a reward or his share of the booty. By the being, in whose hand is the life of Muhammad, if a person gets wounded in Allah's cause, he will arrive on the day of judgment with his wound in the same condition as it was when it was first inflicted. Its color will be blood, but its smell will be musk perfume. If it were not too hard on Muslims, I would not lag behind any raid going out to fight in the cause of Allah. but I do not have abundant means to provide them, the Mujahideens,
or Islamic terrorists,
with riding beasts, nor have they all the means to provide themselves with the weapons of jihad. I love to fight in the way of Allah and be killed, to fight again and to be killed, and to fight and to be killed.
That was the value meal of jihad traditions. For those on a diet, this is a slimmed-down version.
Muslim, Allah has undertaken to provide for one who leaves his home to fight for his cause and to affirm the truth of his word. Allah will either admit him to paradise or will bring him back home with his reward and booty.
For our next tasteless treat, Islam serves up.
The messenger, may peace be upon him.
Don't you just love the knee-jerk, brain-dead idiocy of adding, may peace be upon him, every time these buffoons mention the name of their warlord?
Said, one who is wounded in the way of Allah, and Allah knows better who is wounded in his way, will appear on the day of judgment with his wound still bleeding. The color of its discharge will be blood, but its smell will be musk.
If it was dumb to say once, it's dumber to say twice. So what would you call a man who mumbled such foolishness a third time? Well, Muslims call him Mohammed.
Muhammad, may peace be unto him, said every wound received by a Muslim in the way of Allah will appear on Judgment Day in the same condition it was inflicted, still bleeding profusely. The color...
Well, you know the rest. But then...
By the being in whose hand is Muhammad's life... If it were not hard on Muslims, I would not lag behind in any expedition undertaken for jihad, but I do not possess means to provide Mujahid with riding animals to follow me, nor would it please them to stay behind me.
Since Muhammad called himself a coward, and since he remained home with his harem on 2 out of every 3 Islamic raids, someone must have asked, if this jihad stuff is such a great idea, why aren't you going? So Muhammad repeated,
Muslim, I heard Muhammad, peace be unto him, say, I would not stay behind when an expedition for jihad was being mobilized unless it was going to be too hard on the believers. This is followed by the same words as spoken in the previous traditions, but this hadith has a slight difference in the wording. I love that I should be killed in the way of Allah, then I should be brought back to life and be killed again.
That brings us to the bastardization of what was once a noble word. Martyr is derived from the Greek martus. It means witness, not murderer. Muslim, using the corrupted connotation, devoted his next chapter to
The Merit of Martyrdom.
It begins in chapter 29, book 20, number 4634.
The messenger of Allah, may peace be unto him, said, nobody who dies and has something good for him with Allah will like to return even though he were offered the whole world and all that is in it as an inducement, except the martyr who desires to return and be killed for the merit of martyrdom.
Anyone who believes that
martyrdom,
by Islam's definition, earns
merit
is corrupted beyond words or reason. They are too lost to recognize truth, much less choose it. While we can and should reach and hopefully save bad, peaceful Muslims from the spirit who hates them, our best hope for jihadists is to prevent them from killing us and from corrupting others. Same tune, different lyric.
Muslim, the Prophet said, nobody who enters paradise wants to return, even if he were offered everything on the surface of the earth, except the martyr who will desire to return and be killed 10 times for the sake of the great honor that has been bestowed on him.
By presenting the Muslim Jihad collection, along with compilations contained in the books by Bukhari, Ishaq, Tabari, and Allah, I have revealed 1,000 Islamic scriptures glorifying fighting and booty. Yet the following hadith alone is sufficient to justify the extermination of Islam.
Muslim, the messenger of Allah, may peace be unto him, was asked, what deed could be equivalent to jihad in the way of Allah? He answered, you do not have the strength to do that deed. The question was repeated twice or thrice. Every time he answered, you do not have the strength to do it. When the question was asked for the third time, he said, "One who goes out for jihad is like a person who keeps fasts and stands in prayer forever, obeying Allah's verses, and never exhibiting any weariness in fasting and prayer until the mujahid returns from jihad."
You can die as a jihadist of starvation or sleep deprivation, but with Islam, you're gonna die.
Muslim, as I was sitting near the pulpit of the messenger,
which was a large chair raised high on a platform, in other words, a throne,
a man said, "I do not care if, after embracing Islam, I do not do any good deed except distributing drinking water to pilgrims." Another said, "I do not care if I do not do any good deed beyond maintenance service to the sacred mosque." Yet another said, "Jihad in the way of Allah is better than what you have said." Umar reprimanded them, "Don't raise your voices near the pulpit of the messenger." When the prayer was over, I entered the apartment of the prophet and asked his verdict about the matter. It was upon this that Allah, the Almighty and Exalted, revealed the Quranic verse, "Do you make the giving of drinking water to the pilgrims and the maintenance of the sacred mosque equal to the service of those who believe in Allah and strive hard and fight jihad in his cause? They are not equal. Those who believed and fought jihad in Allah's cause with their wealth and their lives are far higher in degree with Allah."
This is from Quran 9:19. So no matter where you turn, Islam's best deed is jihad. It's hard to believe, but Muslim has a chapter entitled,
"The Merit of Leaving for Jihad in the Morning and Evening." The Messenger of Allah, peace be unto him, said, "Leaving for jihad in the way of Allah in the morning or in the evening will merit a reward better than the world and all that is in it."
As such, jihad is better than Islam's five pillars combined. Jihad is Islam's foundation. Jihad is better than every treasure Muslims plundered, better than every man they murdered, better than every woman they raped, better even than every child they sold into slavery. And while there is no question he said this, it's a lie. Yet it was not his biggest lie, or even his worst lie. Claiming that Allah was God, the God of the Bible, the creator of the universe, and that he spoke for him, was a far more egregious sin. In Muslim's version of the greatest lie ever told, we are confronted by
the high position reserved by Allah for mujahids,
Islamic fighters,
in paradise. The Prophet said, "Whoever cheerfully accepts Allah as his Lord, Islam as his religion, and Muhammad as his apostle, is necessarily entitled to enter paradise." Abu Sa'id wondered at it and said, "Messenger of Allah, repeat that for me." He did that and said, "There is another act which elevates the position of a man in paradise to a grade 100 higher, and the elevation between one grade and the other is equal to the height of heaven from the earth." Sa'id said, "What is that act?" He replied, "Jihad in the way of Allah, jihad in Allah's cause."
The reason Abu Sa'id asked for clarification was that he knew Muhammad was lying. Bukhari, Volume 8, Book 76, number 550, says,
"I heard Allah's apostle saying, 'From my followers there will be a crowd of 70,000 in number who will enter paradise altogether.'"
There have been 3 billion Muslims. That means that the prophet oversold paradise. It's a real bad idea to trust a lying prophet. It's an even worse idea to murder for one.
Muslim, Muhammad,
may he not be believed,
stood up among his companions to deliver his sermon, in which he told them that jihad in the way of Allah and belief in Allah were the most meritorious of acts. A man stood up and said, "Messenger of Allah, do you think that if I am killed in the way of Allah, my sins will be blotted out from me?" The messenger said, "Yes, in case you are killed in the way of Allah, and you were patient and sincere, and you always fought facing the enemy, never turning your back on him." The man asked again. The messenger said, "Yes, if you always fought facing the enemy and never retreated. Gabriel has told me this."
And I suppose Satan taught his disciple how to lie as well, but not very well.
We asked Abdallah about the Quranic verse, "Think not of those who are slain in Allah's way as dead. Nay, they are alive, finding their sustenance in the presence of their Lord." He said, "We asked the Holy Prophet about the meaning of the verse, and he said, 'The souls of martyrs live in the bodies of green birds who have their nests in chandeliers hung from the throne of the Almighty. They eat the fruits of paradise from wherever they like, and then nestle in these chandeliers. Once their Lord cast a glance at them and said, "Do you want anything?" They said, "What more shall we desire? We eat the fruit of paradise from wherever we like." Their Lord asked them the same question thrice. When they saw that they would continue to be asked and not left, they said, "O Lord, we wish that thou mayest return our souls to our bodies, that we may be slain in thy way once again." When he, Allah, saw that they had no need, they were left to their joy.
Souls live in the bodies of green birds who nest in chandeliers. So if that's true, how, pray tell, do they frolic with their virgins? Why do the rivers flow with wine? And why does Allah provide fowl to eat? And one other thing, if Allah knows all, why did he have to pester these little birdies? Under the heading,
"The Merit of Jihad and of Keeping Vigilance Over the Enemy,"
we find Mohammed reconfirming that jihadists are the best Muslims.
A man came to the Holy Prophet,
may he have flown the coop sooner,
and said, "Who is the best of men?" He replied, "A man who fights, staking his life and spending his wealth in Allah's cause." The man asked, "What is next to him in excellence?" He said, "Next to him is a believer who lives isolated in a mountain gorge, worshipping his Lord and sparing men from his mischief."
Whose mischief? Allah or the second best Muslims? Either way, it's not good. The Sunnah, like the Quran, teaches that those who encourage, harbor, and equip terrorists are as good as the terrorists themselves.
Muslim, a man came to the Messenger of Allah, may peace be unto him, and said, "My riding beast has been killed, so give me some animal to ride upon." The Prophet said, "I have none with me." A man said, "I can guide him to a riding beast." Muhammad said, "One who guides to something good has a reward similar to that of its doer." The Messenger said, "Anybody who equips a warrior going to fight in the way of Allah is like one who actually fights, and anybody who looks after his family in his absence is also like one who actually fights."
If this were true, the Fahd family thugs ruling Saudi Arabia would have earned a few billion virgins by now. With scripture like this, it's easy to see why Muslims raise martyrs. It's clear why they celebrate their murderous deeds. Sending a son or daughter off to die terrorizing non-Muslims is actually a selfish act.
Muslim, the Prophet, may peace be upon him, said, "He who equips a warrior in the way of Allah is like one who actually fights, and he who looks after the family of a warrior in Allah's cause, in fact, participated in the battle."
Not that we should need reminding, but here we find that fighting, war, the way of Allah and Allah's cause are synonymous. But there is an escape clause for those who are blind and lame. All others must fight because
jihad is compulsory.
So we read in Muslim chapter 40, book 20, number 4676.
Bara was talking about the Quranic verse, "Believers who sit at home and those who go out for jihad in Allah's cause are not equal."
This is Quran 4:95.
He said that the messenger ordered Zayd, and he brought a shoulder blade of a camel and inscribed it thereon. The son of complained of blindness to the Prophet. At this descended the revelation, "Those believers who sit without any trouble."
Team Islam benched the blind and lame rather than heal them. Muslim claims that there is
proof of the martyrs attaining paradise.
Oh, this ought to be good. For this proof, we must turn to Muslim, chapter 41, book 20, number 4678.
Jabir said that a man said, "Messenger of Allah, where shall I be if I am killed?" He replied, "In paradise." The man threw away the dates he had in his hand and fought until he was killed.
I can only assume that in the minds Muhammad has polluted, Death is proof of life.
Abdallah heard it from his father, who, while facing the enemy, reported that the messenger, may peace be unto him, said, "Surely the gates of paradise are under the shadow of swords." A man in a shabby condition got up and said, "Did you hear the prophet say this?" He said, "Yes." He returned to his friends and said, "I greet you, a farewell greeting." Then he broke the sheath of his sword, threw it away, and advanced with his naked sword toward the enemy and fought with it until he was slain.
I believe that we have stumbled upon something profound. Muhammad is regarded as the sole repository of Islamic proof. But why trust the testimony of an admitted liar? He said,
"War is deceit. Allah has sanctioned the dissolution of your vows."
And,
"If I take an oath and later find something else better than that, then I do what is better and expiate my oath."
Muslims are reliant on this man's witness, and yet he bragged about being a terrorist, a thief, a slave trader, and a liar. And then you have his Quran itself, the worst book ever recited. It's filled with contradictions, historical and scientific errors, and laughably absurd claims. There are grammatical errors, inconsistencies of voice, missing words, and meaningless words. It's gibberish without context, and hellish with it. It's out of order, jumbled together haphazardly. And that's the good news. The bad news is what it actually says. It claims that paradise is a drunken orgy, and that hell is Allah's personal torture chamber. Early on, its most repetitive theme is pain and punishment. The message evolves to perform, obey, and pay. It defines good as fighting and bad as peace. Proof is abundant. It's undeniable. Islam is the most heinous and thinly disguised fraud ever perpetrated on mankind.
Muslim, a desert Arab came to the Prophet, may peace be unto him, and said, "Messenger, one man fights for the spoils of war, another man fights that he may be remembered, and one fights that he may see his high position achieved as a result of his valor and fighting. Which of those is fighting in the cause of Allah?" The messenger of Allah, may peace be unto him, said, "Who fights so that the word of Allah is exalted is fighting in the way of Allah."
If a Muslim
fights
non-Muslims to force Islam on them, he is
exalted.
Islam was never about salvation. It's always about power, control, and especially money. Muslim dedicates a chapter to the Muslim mercenaries. And in case you're curious, there isn't a chapter for Muslim missionaries. Under
"The reward of one who fought and got his share of the booty, and of one who fought but didn't get any booty,"
we find in Muslim chapter 44, book 20, number 4690.
The messenger, may peace be unto him, said, "A troop of soldiers who fight in Allah's cause and get their share of the booty receive in advance two-thirds of their rewards, and in the hereafter one-third will remain to their credit. If they do not receive any booty, they will get their full reward."
Muhammad was trying to keep Allah from looking like a liar. His God had previously promised to reward all surviving jihadists with booty. Islam teaches that jihadists get it now and later.
Muslim, Muhammad said, "A troop of soldiers, large or small, who fight, get their share of the booty and return safe and sound, receive in advance two-thirds of their reward. And a troop of soldiers who return empty-handed and are afflicted or wounded will receive their full reward."
This Islamic insight comes courtesy of Muslim, chapter 49, book 20, number 4699, and also Bukhari, volume 4, book 52, number 47.
Allah's apostle used to visit Haram, daughter of Milhan, the sister of his foster mother. She was the wife of Ubada. One day, the messenger paid her a visit. She entertained him with food and then sat down to pick the lice from his head. The prophet dozed off, and when he awoke, he was laughing. She asked, "What made you laugh?" He said, "Some people from my Ummah,"
Islamic commune,
were fighters in the way of Allah, and were sailing in the sea, gliding smoothly on the water. They appeared to be kings on thrones. She said, Messenger, pray to Allah that he may include me among these warriors. He prayed for her, and then he placed his head and dozed off.
It's hard to believe anyone thinks this is scripture, a divinely inspired revelation. But I am delighted to know that this prophet's head was filled with lice. From Muslim chapter 51, book 20, number 4705, we find,
Muhammad said, A man walks along a path and finds a thorny twig lying along the way and puts it aside. Allah would appreciate it and forgive him.
Forgive him for what?
The prophet said, The martyrs are of five kinds, one who dies of plague, one who dies of diarrhea, one who is drowned, one who is buried under debris,
making the victims of 9/11 martyrs,
and one who dies fighting in Allah's cause. Muslim, Allah's messenger said, Whom do you consider to be a martyr among you? The companion said, One who is slain in Allah's cause is a martyr. He said, Then, if this be the definition of a martyr, the martyrs of my ummah,
Islamic community,
will be small in number. They asked, Prophet, who are the martyrs then? He said, One who is slain in Allah's cause is a martyr. One who dies in the way of Allah is a martyr. One who dies of plague is a martyr. And one who dies of cholera is a martyr.
It's nice to see Muhammad being so inclusive. Now, if he could only be consistent. What happened to those who were buried under debris and those who drowned?
Muslim, I heard the messenger delivering a sermon from the pulpit. Prepare to meet them with as much strength as you can afford. Beware, strength consists in archery. Beware, strength consists in archery. Beware, strength consists in archery. I heard the messenger of Allah, may peace be unto him, say, Lands shall be thrown open to you, and Allah will suffice against you your enemies, but none of you should give up playing with his arrows.
The man who mumbled these words from his lofty perch amid the apartments of his concubines said that he was the closest to the Messiah of all men who ever lived. Yet in the New Covenant, the Messiah said, Love your enemies, do good to those who hate you, bless those who curse you, pray for those who mistreat you. Whoever hits you on the cheek, offer him the other also. And whoever steals your coat, do not withhold your shirt from him either. Treat others the same way you want to be treated. Luke 6:27. If one messenger's message was the opposite of the others, then they couldn't have been speaking for the same God. It bears mention here that archery doesn't appear in the New Covenant. There is no command to fight or to take booty. Jihadists aren't mentioned, much less rewarded. Yet the Quran has a chapter named
The Spoils of War,
and dozens of surahs promote violence. The Hadith dedicates volumes to
Jihad in Allah's cause.
But you won't find a single chapter focused on promoting peace or love in any of Islam's original books. These scriptures are over 10,000 times more violent than the Old Covenant and infinitely more belligerent than the New.
Muslim, Abd al-Rahman said to Uqba, You frequent between these targets, but you are an old man. Hitting them is hard. Uqba said, But for one thing I heard from the Prophet, I would not strain myself. What was that? The Prophet said, Who learnt archery and then gave it up is not from us and is guilty of disobedience to Allah's apostle.
Islam's Prophet said that if a Muslim stopped shooting arrows, he was being disobedient to him, and he was therefore no longer a Muslim. Allah was superfluous. The jihadists have and will continue to fight holy war until the end of time, Islam or infidels.
Muslim, the Holy Prophet, may peace be unto him, said, This religion will continue to exist, and a group of people from the Muslims will continue to fight for its protection until the hour is established.
By fighting, they are protecting Islam. That means it wouldn't endure if left to reason and choice. And that is why we, if we wish to go on living, must create choice by removing Islam's sword.
Muslim, Abd al-Rahman said, I was in the company of Maslama,
the murderer,
and Abdallah,
the assassin.
Abdallah said, "The hour shall come when the worst types of people are left on the earth. They will be worse than the people of pre-Islamic days. They will get whatever they ask of Allah." Maslama said, "Listen to what Abdallah says. He knows better. So far as I'm concerned, I heard the messenger say, a group of people from my ummah will continue to fight in obedience to the command of Allah, remaining dominant over their enemies. Those who oppose them shall not do them any harm. They will remain in this condition until the hour overtakes them." Abdullah said, "Yes. Then Allah will raise something wild, which will be fragrant like musk, and those who touch it will be like silk. It will cause the death of all persons, not leaving behind a single person with an iota of faith in his heart. Then only the worst of men will remain to be overwhelmed by the hour."
This sounds like a prophecy. But since Muhammad said that the hour would come 500 years after his prophetic ministry, he either goofed or all true Muslims are dead, having been wiped out by the fragrant and soft wild something or other. If errant prophecy isn't troubling enough, consider this contradiction from the preceding hadith.
Muslim, Abu Sufyan quoted a tradition from the Prophet, which he related his sermon from the pulpit, saying, "He grants him an understanding of religion. A group of people from the Muslims will remain on the right path and continue until the day of judgment to triumph over those who oppose them."
Bukhari and Muslim both reported,
"Allah's messenger forbade that one should travel to the land of the enemy taking the Quran with him."
Under the chapter heading,
"It is forbidden to take the Quran to the land of the infidels when it is feared that it might fall into their hands,"
Imam Muslim provides clarification,
"Muhammad used to forbid anyone from traveling to the land of the enemy taking the Quran, lest it should fall into the hands of the enemy."
And
"the messenger said, 'Do not take the Quran on a journey with you, for I am afraid lest it would fall into the hand of the enemy.'" Ayub, one of the narrators in the chain of transmitters, said, "The enemy may seize it and may quarrel with you over it."
I would like to ponder the devastating consequence of this final hadith to the mission and message of Islam's lone prophet. It confirms that the Quran was not a godly revelation designed to reveal truth or to save mankind. Non-Muslims weren't to see it. Therefore, the sole purpose of the armed assaults against the infidels was for power, for land, and for money. Religion didn't play into the equation. The scriptures were not to be shared. That also means that no one became a Muslim based upon Muhammad's Quran recitals. All Muslims submitted to the sword of Islam. They were simply indoctrinated later. There are some other troubling sidebars here. The Quran didn't exist as a book, and there was no divine or prophetic order to turn it into one. To say that it could not be taken is to say that Muslim militants had to wipe the poisonous poetry from their minds before they set off to slay infidels. So then, why were they fighting, if not for booty? Most troubling of all is that Muhammad knew that he had perpetrated a scam. He knew his Quran recitals would not stand up to scrutiny. Literate people, godly people, would make a farce of them, so Muhammad didn't want his Quran seen by anyone who was free to think, free to speak, free to choose. It was only after Islam eliminated these freedoms that Islam's message was to be revealed, and then it was too late. Before we part company, I want to expose one of the most obscure details of the Quran to demonstrate the direct correlation between Islam and the tragic events unfolding before our eyes. Between 2,000 and 3,000 years ago, real prophets named Daniel, Ezekiel, and Isaiah, and a former fisherman named John, foretold events that would shadow our last days. Central to their prognostications was that an international coalition led by Gog, the leader of Magog, would attack Israel. They also warned that a nation known for its wings and naval prowess, a land across the sea, divided by rivers, an aggressive, fair-skinned people who had separated themselves from God, America, would be pruned back like a diseased grapevine. So what? Israel has been invaded more times than Muhammad had concubines, and America remains the undisputed heavyweight champ of the world. Well, the first snip of the pruning shears was 9/11. The second was the $1 trillion impact on the nation's economy. The third was the bloodletting in Iraq, where Americans engendered the wrath of the world and gained nothing. This predicted war isn't Badar, a skirmish between militants and merchants. It's World War III. To borrow a phrase from a former tyrant, this will be the mother of all battles. The prophets appear to be saying that Gog, most likely the leader of a combined Iran-Iraq at the time, will form an alliance entirely comprised of Islamic nations, the legacy of Mohammed. Egypt, Syria, Ethiopia, Libya, the Sudan, Iraq, and Turkey will join the southern tier of Islamic nations that comprise the Russian Federation, the Stans, and the Chechens. Collectively, they will unleash hell's fury. Beginning with their normal pincer attack, Egypt and Syria will break a peace treaty to simultaneously assault Israel from the north and from the south. The conflict will devolve into a chemical, biological, and nuclear war. But the Muslims will lose. 1 billion of Mohammed's followers and 500 million infidels will die over the course of a year and a half. 1/3 of the earth's surface will be scorched. America, weakened and humiliated, will protest. A united Europe will answer the call and defend Israel, but not for the sake of the Jews, of course. An unholy trinity will covet what belongs to Yahweh, His promised land and His people. The catalyst for this war will be as all others. A wolf in sheep's clothing will use it to affirm a land for peace treaty that will broker a temporary peace between Israel and her Muslim neighbors, guaranteeing security for the Jews in the promised land. This world leader will arise from what was the intersection of Alexander the Great's Grecian Empire and the Roman Empire. He will become the Antichrist. His allies will be Satan and the false prophet. You know who Satan is, so a word about the other guy. He will be an ecumenical religious leader, uniting much of the world into a single, universal, and tolerant doctrine. His religion will be closely allied with that of ancient Babylon, the same religion that forms the basis of both Catholicism and Islam. The implied pruning of America is because we've separated ourselves from Yahweh. And it certainly sounds bad, as does the death of 1/4 of the earth's population. But what obscure detail in the Quran, you may be asking, led to this horrific peak at our destiny? The answer is Gog and Magog. Allah mentions them twice, once in Quran 18:94, then again in 21:96. Since Muhammad was illiterate and Allah was dumb as a stone, the source of this material is obvious. It came from Yathrib rabbis. They knew Yahweh's prophecies, and they understood their implications. But not knowing any better, Muhammad included within his own scriptures the very event that would one day lay his legacy to ruin. In a surah insightfully named
The Prophets,
we find this jewel.
Quran 21:92. Verily, this brotherhood of Islam is a single religion. And I am your Lord, therefore worship me. But later generations broke into fragment as regards to their religion, one from another.
This generation of Muslims has spent more time fighting amongst themselves than attacking infidels. But the Bible, and through it the Quran, predicts that this will soon change.
Yet they will all return to us
to make war on Israel.
Therefore, whoever shall do good
fighting
deeds as a believer, there shall be no denying of his exertion, and surely we will write it down for him in his book of deeds.
Then speaking of Jews, it says,
but there is a ban on any population which we have destroyed, that they shall not return until Gog and Magog are let loose from their barrier, and they swoop down, swarming from every hill, letting loose and breaking forth from every elevated place. Then will the true promise of doom draw nigh. Behold, the disbelieving infidels will be terrorized, staring in horror. Woe to us! Alas! We made a state heedless of this. We did wrong.
Wise and cunning as ever, the Jews who sold Muhammad his scripture infused it with an admonition. Do not build a state without heeding this warning. But this is exactly what Israel has done. Yet 1,400 years ago, Yathrib Jews hooked Muhammad. He took the bait and swam with it, not knowing that he was being used to predict his own demise.
Quran 21:98. Verily, you disbelieving infidels, and the gods that you worship besides Allah are the fuel for hell, faggots for the fire. Certainly you will enter it. Had their idols been real ilah, or gods, they would have kept them out of hell. Therein sobbing will be your lot, breathing with deep sighs, roaring. You will hear nothing but wailing and groaning.
He calls this,
in Quran 21, verse 103, the greatest terror, the supreme horror, the fearful event. The angels will meet them. This is the day
of doom,
of which you were promised, the day that we shall roll up the world like a scroll, a promise binding on us. Surely we will bring it about.
Amongst all this hate speech, there is a problem. Allah is allegedly talking to disbelieving infidels, but they, according to Muhammad, were never to see this book. So why are these threats here? What purpose do they serve? Dumb to the bitter end, Muhammad ends his prophecy by confirming that the source of his inspiration was the Bible, although he got the section wrong.
Quran 21, verse 105, certainly we wrote this prophecy before in the scripture given to Moses, the message, my righteous slaves shall inherit the earth.
The Gog prophecy is in Ezekiel, not the Torah. And Muslims will never inherit the earth, although they will die trying. The Islamic Mahdi, known in Ezekiel as Gog, will in fact bring a day of doom. As you listen to this next verse, remember that the words and phrases inside of the parentheses are not mine. They were added by the translators so that we might understand what Allah is saying.
Quran 21, verse 106. Verily, in this
Quran
is a message, a plain statement for folks who worship Allah,
and for those who act practically on the Sunnah, the legal ways of the Prophet.
And we sent you,
Muhammad,
not as but a mercy for mankind and jinns. Say,
Muhammad,
it is revealed to me that your Ilah,
God,
is only one Ilah,
God.
Will you submit to his will
and become Muslims?
But if they,
disbelievers, Christians and Jews,
turn away
from Islam,
say, I give notice
of war
to be known to all, but I know not whether the
torment which you were
threatened is nigh or far.
It is nigh. The second prophecy of
the great terror
proceeding from the Magog
sweeping swarm
comes from a surah entitled
The Cave.
But before we read the story, I'd like to turn your attention to a footnote in the Ahmed Ali translation. It says,
Quran commentators identify Dhul Qarnayn with Alexander the Great of Macedonia, as he is the closest in his travels, wisdom, and
Islamic
prophethood to the description.
The problem with the theory is that Alexander was a pagan. He said that he was a sun god, and he died in a drunken stupor. He never mentioned Allah, the moon god of Mecca, nor visited his rock house. So as not to let the facts get in our way, let's listen to what Muhammad claims Allah had to say in his perfect book. But before we do, I want you to remember that the reason for the 18th surah is that following the satanic verses, the Meccans challenged Muhammad to answer three questions. He was told that these questions were proposed by the Jews, and that only one who was a true prophet would know their answers. So Muhammad, isolated as he was now, from his Yathrib Jewish sources and from his Yemenite Christian source, was forced to conceive surahs on his own. This is the result.
Quran 18, verse 83. They will ask you of Dhul Qarnayn. Say, shall I recite something of his story? Verily, we established his power on earth and gave him the ways and means to all ends. He followed a course until it reached the setting place of the sun. He found it setting in a spring of hot, black, muddy water.
Remember, Muhammad wasn't very smart, and his spirit's inspiration wasn't of any value. Earlier in the hadith, we read that the sun set each night in a muddy spring. The Quran is verifying that truth. The Islamic scripture goes on to say,
And he found near the murky spring a people thereabout.
In an adjoining hadith, Muhammad explained that the people who lived near the sun's muddy spring setting place were extraterrestrials.
Tabari, Allah created two cities out in space. Were those people not so many and noisy, all the inhabitants of this world would hear the loud crash made by the sun falling when it rises and when it sets. Gabriel took me to them during my night journey from the sacred mosque,
the Kaaba,
to the farthest mosque,
the Jewish temple, which was no longer on Mount Moriah.
I told the people of these cities to worship Allah, but they refused to listen to me.
I suppose this proves that extraterrestrials are smarter than humans. So now that you know which people Alexander was visiting, and that neither Allah nor Muhammad can be trusted, we'll return to this Quranic fairy tale.
We, Allah, said by inspiration, O Dhu'l-Qurnayn, either you punish them or treat them with kindness.
For a frame of reference, Allah is offering his capricious advice to Alexander the Great as he surveys beings living around the murky spring in which the sun goes to bed at night.
Quran 18, verse 87. He said, whoever does wrong, a disbeliever in Allah, as for him,
the extraterrestrial,
we,
Alexander the Great's troops,
shall punish. Then shall he be sent back to his Lord, and he will punish him with a terrible torture unheard of before. But as for him who believes,
in what? Alexander was a pagan.
And works good deeds, he shall have the best reward.
From whom? Alexander worshipped the sun.
And we shall speak mild words unto him.
Since the Quran opens with stories of harsh rants, followed by demented threats, and concludes with orders to mutilate and murder all who resist, he couldn't have quoted from Allah's book. And since Alexander is famous for being history's greatest warrior, it's safe to say his words were no milder than,
punish him with a terrible torture unheard of before. Quran 18, verse 89. Then followed he another way until he came to the rising place of the sun.
And where might that be?
He found it rising on a people for whom we, Allah, had provided no covering protection against the sun. So it was, and we knew all about him.
Said Professor Allah, proving the Quran wasn't inspired by a rational being. But this brings us back to Islam's poison pill, albeit more colorfully this time.
Quran 18:92. Then he followed
another
course until, when he reached
a tract
between two mountains, he found beneath them a people who scarcely understood a word.
Meccans, perhaps.
They said, O Dhu'l-Qurnayn, verily the Gog and Magog do great mischief on earth, and they are spoiling our land.
In the previous surah, Gog was not to arrive until the last day. Now they are making mischief in a time long past. And, by the way, the Quran doesn't describe these critters as people. Quran 21:92 said,
Gog and Magog are let loose from their barrier, and they swoop down, swarming.
And that may be why these mischief-makers are associated with Alexander's extraterrestrial activities. The 94th verse continues with the
people who scarcely understood a word,
saying,
shall we then pay you tribute in order that you might erect a barrier between us and them? He said that the wealth, authority, and power,
a.k.a. Islam,
in which my Lord has established me, is better than your tribute. So help me, therefore, with strength of men and labor. I will erect a strong barrier between you and them.
As an interesting aside, the Jewish rabbis would have known that Arabia wouldn't join in Magog's attack on Israel, and that the mischief they unleashed would spoil the land. Further, the pagan, Alexander, was being presented as an Islamic prophet to help validate Muhammad's claim that he, David, and Solomon were Muslims. But alas, history and archaeology affirm that Alexander was a pagan, that David and Solomon were Jews, and that Alexander didn't build a great barrier anywhere. Thus, Allah is lying, something he does with great consistency. And these lies were not without consequence. Islam was based on the proposition that Abraham was a Muslim, serving Allah, as were Moses and Christ. While Muhammad's case was never believable, we now have irrefutable proof that he and his dark spirit were willing to lie in the Quran. The fabricated Alexander the Great is alleged to have said,
in Quran 18, verse 96, "Bring me
blocks
of iron." Then, when he had filled up the gap between the two mountainsides, he said, "Blow." Then, when he had made them
red
as fire
by blowing on an iron wall,
he said, "Bring me molten lead, copper, brass to pour over them." Thus Gog and Magog were made powerless to scale it or dig a hole in it.
Dhul-Qarnayn
said, "This is a mercy from my Lord, but when the promise of my Lord comes to pass, he will make it into dust, and the promise of my Lord is ever true. On that day,"
the day of Gog and Magog, when they come out,
"we shall leave them to surge like waves on one another. The trumpet will be blown, and we shall collect them,"
the creatures,
"all together, in one gathering in conflict. And we shall present hell that day for the disbelievers to see, all spread out in plain view. Verily, we have prepared hell for the hospitality of infidels. Hell is for the disbelievers' entertainment."
At least Allah hasn't lost his touch. He remains the most devilishly demonic deity ever devised. But then, I suppose, a god who would call hell entertainment is a perfect match for a warlord who entertains himself torturing men and raping women.
Quran 18:103. Say, "Shall we inform you of who will be the greatest losers? Those who reject my revelations. Hell is their reward because they rejected Islam and took my proofs, verses, and lessons, and those of my messengers by way of jest in mockery."
In all fairness, it's pretty hard not to mock such foolishness. And speaking of foolishness, Muhammad bequeathed his faithful with a Magog hadith. This is found in Bukhari, Volume 9, Book 88, Number 249.
"One day Allah's apostle entered upon her in a state of fear and said, 'None has the right to be worshipped but Allah. Woe to the Arabs from the great evil that has approached them. Today a hole has been opened in the dam.'"
This is Alexander's iron barrier between the mountains, as described in the 18th surah.
"Of Gog and Magog, like this. The prophet made a circle with his index finger and thumb. I said, 'O Allah's apostle, shall we be destroyed, though there will be righteous people among us?' The prophet said, 'Yes, if the number of evil persons increases.'"
Somebody had a wild imagination. One might even call it hallucinogenic. Although it's a small point, Muhammad was not smart enough to know that Gog was a person and that Magog is a coalition. So enough with the fairy tale. According to the Bible, Islam will lead to the destruction of much of the world. I share this with you so that you might appreciate the cost of tolerating the terrorist dogma of Islam rather than freeing Muslims from it. And equally important, I want you to be prepared for what is to come, because it will happen. Yet millions can be saved from it. I know the future because, unlike Muhammad, Isaiah, Daniel, Ezekiel, and John were real prophets. By putting their predictions together, we can reasonably deduce that 6,000 years after Adam and Chava, who we call Eve, made the wrong choice, Yahweh will put an end to man's destructive deceptions, false prophets, ignorance, and sin. He wants to establish a new world order, one without deceit, disease, death, or damnation. Yet, true to his character and purpose, he wants the final choice to remain ours, not his. Yahweh simply removes his spirit from the earth, enabling those who remain to plot their own course. Totally separated from Yahweh, the prophets predict humanity will choose poorly. The world will plummet into chaos. The story of Islam's ultimate demise is but one of many tragic tales that collectively comprise what Scripture calls the tribulation, the last 7 years of man's rule on planet Earth. Isaiah, in addition to writing about the arrival and nature of the Messiah, was inspired by Yahweh to foretell how Satan would form Islam. Then he predicted the events that would lead to the nation of Islam attacking Israel, engulfing the world in war. Daniel explains that it will begin, as did World War II, with a peace treaty. Foolishly, the world trusts nations whose official God and prophet order them to disavow such oaths. As a result, a third of the earth's surface is scorched, Revelation 8:7. A quarter of its people die, Revelation 6:8, including the annihilation of 5 out of every 6 Muslims, Ezekiel 39:2. I want to provide you with an overview of this battle so that you might be saved from its devastation. Starting in the 9th chapter, Isaiah speaks of rebuilding Jerusalem with dressed stone, which is exactly what has happened. Every building is covered in white limestone. Then, describing martyrdom parades in Gaza, he says the Philistines, the people after whom the Palestinians derive their name, will devour Israel from the west with open mouths. Speaking of Israelis who want to trade land for peace, he proclaims, "Those who guide mislead. They have not sought Yahweh." Consistent with the couplet nature of the Psalms, most of these prophecies have a dual fulfillment, one relatively near and one destined for our time. Isaiah presents them in parallel, much the same way he predicted the first and second coming of the Messiah. Then, stealing a page from yesterday's newspaper, Isaiah reveals that Yahweh will judge Assyria, today's Iraq. He's angry because they're a godless people, seizing loot and snatching plunder. They will be trampled down in the streets. Yahweh promises to plunder its leader and to waste its warriors, all in advance of World War III. Yahweh tells us that a noisy army will attack Babylon. There will be an uproar among the kingdoms as this army musters for war. Terror will seize them. While I cannot say for certain, this seems an awful lot like what America is doing today in 2003 as I write these words. For Israel, there is good and bad news. More Jews will settle in the Promised Land, and they will ultimately prevail. On that day, Yahweh provides relief from suffering, turmoil, and cruel bondage. Unfortunately, one of Israel's allies will be the Antichrist, the human embodiment of Satan, but not for long. The morning star has fallen from the heaven and been cast down to the earth. He who once laid low the nations will be brought to the depths of the pit. While the Palestinians will rejoice, Isaiah predicts that their partnership with the devil will bite them. "Do not rejoice, O you Philistines. A shifty and venomous serpent will spring up. Wail at the gate. Howl, O city. Melt away, all you Philistines. The answer shall be given to the envoys of that nation, that Yahweh has established Israel, and her afflicted people will find refuge." Jordan opts out of the war, but it makes no difference. The Islamic armies march through, ravaging the nation. Describing some of Islam's most peculiar rites, 1,000 years before they were invented, Isaiah says, "Every head is shaved, every beard is cut off. They will wear sackcloth in the streets and public squares. They will all wail, prostrating themselves." The Jordanians will actually flee into Israel as the attacking nations plunder their land. In the 17th chapter, Isaiah says that today's oldest continuously occupied city will be laid to waste. Damascus will no longer be a city, but will become a heap of ruins. Moving on to Israel, he predicts, "In that day the glory of Jacob, which is Israel, will fail. The fat body will waste away." The thinning of Israel could well be a land for peace accord that thins Israel at the waist by giving Muslims the West Bank and Gaza, a move that will lead to the death of millions of Jews. The timing follows what Isaiah refers to as the harvest. This is the removal of believers, thus Yahweh's spirit, from the earth. "I will not be here to see any of this happen. I pray that you are with me." The survivors of this dreadful time will finally turn back to their Creator. Perhaps speaking of America, the prophet predicts, "In that day their strong cities, which they left because of the Israelites, will be like places abandoned to the thickets and undergrowth, and all will be desolation." Much of the reason Muslims laid New York and Washington buildings to waste, and will ultimately waste entire American cities with biological and nuclear weapons, is because the United States supports Israel. Isaiah says of this country, You have forgotten Yahweh, your Savior. You have separated yourself from your fortress. Though you set out the finest plants, of course the U.S. is the world's leading food producer, and plant imported vines, a reference to Christians, though you make them grow, when it is time for the final harvest, there will be nothing but incurable disease and pain. Next, the prophet says something that sounds like he's been watching the worldwide uproar against America following our invasion of Iraq. Oh, the raging of many nations! They rage like the raging sea. Oh, the roar of the people! They roar like the roaring of great waters. Although the people roar like surging waters, when rebuked they flee, driven before the wind like chaff on a hill, like tumbleweeds before a gale. Describing the methods of Islamic jihadists and America's inability to see them for what they really are, Isaiah reports, "In the evening, sudden terror. Before morning, they are gone. This is the portion of those who loot us, the lot of those who plunder us." While Muslims see America as Israel's best friend, this nation has actually been the only country to loot the young state, and the U.S. has done it repeatedly. Following each Arab-Israeli conflict, America has taken the lead in demanding that Israel abandon the Sinai, abandon Lebanon, abandon the Golan, abandon Gaza, abandon East Jerusalem, and abandon the West Bank. This was done to improve America's relations with Islamic nations so that their dictators would either buy American military hardware or sell oil more cheaply. The U.S. required Israel to give up something they possessed to gain something America wanted. Continuing to speak of what may be America, Isaiah says, "Woe to the land of whirling wings," could well be ancient Hebrew for airplane or helicopter, the symbols of America's military might. "Past the rivers of Cush," which means west of Africa from the perspective of Israel, "that sends envoys and ambassadors by sea and ships. They are swift messengers from a tall and smooth-skinned people, feared far and wide, an aggressive nation of strange speech whose land is divided by rivers." From the perspective and vocabulary of a man writing nearly 3,000 years ago, that's a pretty respectable description of America circa the dawn of the 21st century. Perhaps speaking of the power of television, Isaiah shares a vision that was impossible until recently. "All you people of the world, you who live on the earth, when the banner is raised on the mountains, you will see it. When the trumpet sounds, you will hear it. This is what Yahweh said to me. I will remain quiet and will look on from my dwelling place, like shimmering heat in the sunshine, like a cloud of dew in the heat of the harvest." That is to say, the calamity that is to come will come from man and not from God. Yahweh is just reporting what will occur. He tells us that His truth remains illuminating and that He will remain as close to us as the dew is to the harvest. The harvest, in biblical nomenclature, could be the reaping of souls in the rapture, when those with Yahweh's Spirit are harvested from the earth and called to Him. This rapture is the final predicted event prior to the peace treaty and the beginning of the tribulation. "For before the harvest, when the blossom is gone and the flower becomes a ripening grape, He will cut off the shoots with pruning knives and cut down and take away the spreading branches. They will all be left to the birds of prey." If this is a description of America, then we are being told that before the rapture, the nation will be pruned and that our influence around the globe will be cut back. The prophet goes on to speak about Egypt, the nation that starts the war. He says that the Nile will dry up, that brother will fight brother, and that they will lose heart. Egypt is the center of Islamic scholarship today. He says, "Where are your wise men now? Let them show you and make known what Yahweh has planned for Egypt. The officials have become like fools, the leaders are deceived, and have led many astray, pouring into them a spirit of dizziness. They make Egypt stagger as a drunkard in its own vomit." The land of Israel will bring terror to the Egyptians. Fortunately, a remnant of the Egyptians and Assyrians will return to Yahweh, and He will bless them. Following Muhammad's example, the Saudis will consider themselves too important to fight. They flee from the sword and from the heat of battle. Their warriors will be few. Isaiah reports what will ultimately occur in the Middle East. the heart of the nation of Islam. Like the whirlwind sweeping through the southland, an invader comes from the desert, from the land of terror. A dire vision has been shown to me. The traitor betrays, the looter loots. Iran's alliance lays siege. I will bring to an end all of the groaning she has caused. Speaking in first person about Israel, Isaiah predicts, At this my body is racked with pain, like a woman in labor. I am staggered by what I hear. I am bewildered by what I see. Fear makes me tremble. The twilight I longed for has become a horror to me. Ultimately, he predicts, the earth will be laid waste and plundered, defiled by its people. They have disobeyed the instructions and broken the covenant. Therefore, they must bear the guilt. The earth's inhabitants are burned up, and very few are left. All the merrymakers groan. The cities are desolate. The doors to homes are barred. All joy turns to gloom. Islam does this to humankind. With treachery, the treacherous betray. Terror, pit and snare await you, people of the earth. Whoever flees at the sound of terror will fall into a pit. Whoever climbs out of the pit will be caught by a snare. Collectively, these dire predictions of the winds of war should be sufficient for you to want to be part of the solution rather than the problem. For ultimately, Yahweh prevails. He wins the final battle, Armageddon, where all of the world's armies march into Israel, only to be thwarted. Death loses its sting. Disease exists no more. Suffering is abolished. Evil is removed from the earth, and man lives in the very presence of his Maker. Yes, unwittingly, Islam predicted its own demise. It will be extinguished as it was born. Muhammad was unable to give his followers a reason to live, so he gave all Muslims a reason to die. And tragically they shall. Allah's prophet sacrificed 3 billion souls on the altar of his own selfish ambitions. The Messiah was the inverse of Muhammad. He made himself a living sacrifice, building a bridge between our polluted world and his perfect one. He died that we might live. He lives that we might never die.